Good morning, everybody, and welcome to Westheights Community Church. My name is Kyle, and I just have a couple quick announcements for you this morning. The first of which is, today is the last day to drop off your donations for the Community Center collection. This month, we have been collecting shampoo and conditioner, hand soap, baby wipes, and adult diapers. This is a great way for us to be involved in something awesome that is happening in our community that is helping others. A second announcement has to do with our after the service foyer meetings. This week, we are having two. The first of which is our normal kind of foyer gathering that we have after every digital service. And this will be a great time for catching up, for just being in community with one another. And the second foyer meeting that we're having today as well is a prayer meeting. So if that is something that you're interested in, the link for that will be in the description below. The link for both of the foyer meetings will be in the description below, and we hope that one of those will work for you today. And now for a time of worship.
Hello, Westheights, and happy Eastertide. In more traditional Christian churches, this would be called the third Sunday of Easter because they celebrate 50 days of Easter in the calendar, making it into a whole season, which seems like a good idea to continue to be reminded to live in the light of the resurrection. And I thought of an old song, an old favorite song of mine called Hope of the Nations that reflects some of that. Maybe it's one of those songs that's so old it might be new again, which is fitting, I suppose. I think it just speaks so well of the hope and life that comes from Jesus, and I know we could all use a little hope right now. The line that really stood out to me, though, is, "You rose from the dead, conquering fear," and that was probably because I'm reading a book right now about the fear of death and how it's so common to our human condition. It quotes Hebrews 2, 14 and 15, and the Message version of that, those verses reads, "Since the children are made of flesh and blood, it's logical that the Savior took on flesh and blood in order to rescue them by his death. By embracing death, taking it into himself, he destroyed the devil's hold on death and freed all who cower through life, scared to death of death. Thanks be to God for sending Jesus, who sets us free from the fear of death. He is our hope." Jesus, hope of the nations, Jesus, comfort for all who mourn. You are the source of heaven's hope on earth. Jesus, light in the darkness, Jesus, truth in each circumstance. You are the source of heaven's light on earth. In history, you lived and died. You broke the chains. You rose to life. You are the hope living in us. You are the rock in whom we trust. You are the light shining for all the world to see. You rose from the dead, conquering fear, a prince of peace, drawing us near. Jesus, our hope, living for all who will receive. Lord, we Jesus, hope of the nations, Jesus, comfort for all who mourn. You are the source of heaven's hope on earth. Jesus, light in the darkness, Jesus, truth in each circumstance. You are the source of heaven's light on earth. In history, you lived and died. You broke the chains. You rose to life. You are the hope living in us. You are the rock in whom we trust.
You are the light shining for all the world to see. You rose from the dead, conquering fear, a Prince of Peace, drawing us near. Jesus, our hope, living for all who will receive. Lord, we believe. Lord, we believe. In history, you lived and died. You broke the chains. You rose to life. You are the hope living in us. You are the rock in whom we trust. You are the light shining for all the world to see. You rose from the dead, conquering fear, a Prince of Peace, drawing us near. Jesus, our hope, living for all the world. Lord, we believe. Lord, we believe. Lord, we believe. Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now I'm found. Was blind, but now I see. 'Twas grace that taught my heart to fear, and grace my fears relieved. Now precious did that grace appear the hour I first believed. My chains are gone, I've been set free. My God, my Savior has ransomed me, and like a flood His mercy reigns, unending love, amazing grace. The Lord has promised good to me, His word my hope secures. He will my shield and portion be, as long as life endures. My chains are gone, I've been set free. My God, my Savior has ransomed me, and like a flood His mercy reigns, unending love, amazing grace. When we've been there 10,000 years, bright shining as the sun, we've no less days to sing God's praise than when we first begun. My chains are gone, I've been set free. My God, my Savior has ransomed me, and like a flood His mercy reigns, unending love, amazing grace. The earth shall soon dissolve like snow, the sun forbear to shine. but God who called me here below will be forever mine. Will be forever mine. You are forever mine.
Well, good morning, Westheights. It's good to be together again this morning. My hope is that our time of worship was a time when God spoke to our hearts. You know, there's a lot of stuff that's been going on this week, whether it be personally or things going on in our world. A lot of reasons why our hearts might be going, oh, really? And, you know, moments of worship like we just had are opportunities for God to speak to us as our hearts are. And so my hope and my prayer is that we each heard God speak to our hearts as they are this morning. Today in our teaching time, we have a guest speaker. Our guest speaker is Matt Vincent. He works for the Be in Christ Church of Canada. That is our denominational family, and he is the team leader of the Reunion Network of Churches. Now, Matt's going to tell us a little bit more about the Reunion Network in the beginning of his time with us, and so I'll let him kind of unpack that. But in short, the Reunion Network is sort of like our church planting expression here in the Be in Christ Church. And they're doing some really good work. And back in the fall, our church board or church leadership heard that the Reunion Network was doing some great work, and we wanted to get behind that. And we also heard that they had some need for some financial support, and so we made a one-time gift to the Reunion Network of churches. And because we believe again that they're doing good stuff, and we want to be able to support that and cheer them on. And so that one-time gift was on behalf of our church family to the Reunion Network, because we believe that what they're doing is good. And so we're excited to hear Matt share with us a little bit about what the Reunion Network is doing this morning, as well as speak to us and about something that I think can help us as a church family grow in our understanding of what does it mean to be a community of followers of Jesus, and what does it mean to engage others for Jesus. And so we're looking forward to Matt sharing with us this morning. Now, before we get into our teaching time, let's just spend a few moments in prayer, shall we? Lord Jesus, we do want to say thank you for today. Thank you for the opportunities to worship you and to hear from your word like we are doing this morning. God, we acknowledge that this isn't how we would choose to gather as a church family. And yet, God, we know that you are present. That in the way that we are gathering, as we worship together, as we pray together, as we focus on you together, Lord, that you are present and that you are moving. And so, Lord, we thank you that you are present even in situations that we think are less than ideal, God, that you are there. So thank you, God. Lord, as we deal with the continuing implications of this COVID-19 pandemic, Lord, the last few weeks have just felt heavy for so many of us. Lord, our souls are just groaning under the weight of restrictions, under the weight of concerns and fear. And Lord, this morning we ask that you would come and meet us in those places of concern and fear and anxiety and loneliness, God. That you would minister to our hearts, that you would bring healing to our wounds. That you would comfort us in our loneliness. And Lord, as your people, that we would have eyes to see how we can be a part of your healing presence in the lives of others. Lord, that you would inspire us to be creative with the things that we can do and our abilities to respond to the needs of others. Lord, that you would help us to be people who are generous with our time, our energy, our resources. Lord, that you would use us to bring your healing into this time that just seems so full of hurt and anxiety. Lord, this week we have once again been reminded of the realities of racism that continue to exist in our world. Lord, as much as we try to think, we would like to think that racism is a thing of the past, Lord, we've had two reminders this week of its continuing presence. And as much as we'd like to think that racism is something that happens in other parts of the world, it doesn't happen here, Lord. We need to acknowledge that in our hearts lies the potential, perhaps the reality that we see others as being different and not as important as us, sometimes based on the color of their skin. And so, Lord, I ask that in this time of awareness, that you would cause us to do reflection on the reality of our own heart and our own posture towards others. Lord, that you would reveal in us things that could be the seeds of prejudice. And Lord, that you would do the hard work in us through your Holy Spirit, rooting out those weeds, rooting out those things that would cause us to treat others as being less than who you designed them to be. Lord, as we watch the events happening in the States, as we grow in our awareness of how racism is real, even in our own nation, even our own city, Lord, I pray that you would give us a holy discontent, that, Lord, you would cause us to not be okay with the status quo and not just shrug our shoulders and say, well, that's just the way it is. But, Lord, that in each of us would have a real anger, perhaps, at injustice when we see it. And, Lord, that you would use us to be agents of your reconciliation, bringing your peace into this place, this time and place that we live. Lord, that we would be people whose posture is open and curious as we engage people. Lord, that we would be people who are willing to engage in dialogue, willing to stand up for what is right, willing to listen, willing to be wrong even. And so, Lord, cultivate in us a heart that is humble, a heart that is full of your love. Now, God, as we turn towards our teaching time this morning, we thank you for Matt. We thank you for his presence here with us. Lord, we ask that you would give us ears to hear what you want to say to us this morning. In your name we pray. Amen.
Hey, West Heights. Matt Vincent here. Obviously, wish we could be together in person. But as this year keeps going on and the way it's going, I'm at least glad we can connect this way. Maybe at some point down the line, we can hang out together in person. But thanks for letting me be a part of your gathering, your service, even online today. By way of introduction, for those of you who don't know me, I kind of became a part of the broader BIC family back in 2007 when I came on staff at the Meeting House. And I was there from 2007 till 2014. And then at that point, I made a shift and started working for the denomination, being Christ Church of Canada, giving leadership to what we call the Reunion Network, which is the church planting, experimental, let's try new things kind of part of our denominational family. And so I've been around for a little while. We may not have had the chance to meet, but when I came to the Meeting House and then to the broader BIC family, it definitely felt for me as a follower of Jesus that I had finally found the place that just feels like home. Theologically and our desire and our roots and how we pursue Jesus, it just felt like a homecoming. So I've been glad to be a part of this crew, this family, and glad to connect this way. Married to a woman named Bobby. We've been married 21 years and we have three kids, Tabea, Silas, and Hadley, 19, 17, and 15 years old. And we have a French bulldog named Moose that on any given day could be the favorite family member for all of us, depending on how things are going with lockdown. So we're good. We live in Ancaster, Ontario. And again, love to be a part of this. I should also say, just off the very top, I just want to say a huge thank you to the Westheights family. Back in the fall, I was doing a run to raise money for the Reunion Network for church planting. And the idea was I was going to run about 100 kilometers, run from the Niagara region, which is kind of like one of the heartland areas for historical BIC churches. And I was going to run back to Oakville, where we first planted a church in 2014. And so for five consecutive days, I ran just over a half marathon in distance each day. So five half marathons back to back to back. In total, it was about 112 kilometers over 5 days trying to raise money. And you guys were a huge support. You made a generous donation. You may not know that, so surprise, you did. And I just want to say on behalf of the Reunion Network and our church planting efforts, I just want to say a huge thank you for your willingness to partner, support, believe in what we're doing. So we're really, really grateful. Thank you. For our time together, here's what I thought I'd do. I thought I'd give you a little bit of info, backstory on who the Reunion Network is, what we're all about, because it might be new for some of you. And then I'll use the second part of it to talk about some of the things we're discovering as we're establishing and planting new churches. And I know you guys as a church have been having conversations for a number of years on what does it mean to reach out to people who are open, spiritually curious, willing to explore and have conversations, but aren't really connected to any church and kind of have baggage with the idea of organized religion. So they're spiritual and curious, but not religious. That term may be, or that idea may be familiar to you. And so I think some of the things maybe that we are learning in our efforts to establish spiritual communities that follow Jesus might be something that would encourage and mean something to you. So that's what I think I'll do. I'll break it up into two kind of sections. So first, reunion. What is that all about? So in 2014, I left my role at the Meeting House, and I was hired to do two part-time jobs. One was to plant a church, to experiment with that, and the other was to help other people who were considering planting churches. So first, we started meeting in our home, believing that God was inviting us into this idea and adventure of establishing a new church community. We were living in Oakville, Ontario at the time, and honestly, we had no idea what we were doing, other than we had this strong sense that this is what God was doing and leading. And so we just started meeting in the living room of our townhouse, started inviting friends over, starting to pray, to talk about this all together, and we began to practice some regular rhythms together every time we were together. We began to share a meal together, we began to read scripture, we prayed, we shared communion every time we were together, and we looked for ways to be involved in the community around us. So even though we didn't know what we were going to be about as a church, we didn't even have a name at that point, we began to operate with these rhythms of life that have been really the kind of the hallmarks of the followers of Jesus for the whole time, the whole history of the church. And so that's just kind of what we started doing. And then one day, I thought, you know, we were tossing around ideas for a church name. We thought it would be good for us to know who we are and have a name to go by. I was out for a run. I should say I'm not a runner. I've already mentioned running a couple times. So please know there are runners who are like those graceful gazelles who you just see floating down the street. That's not me. I'm more like I got lead boots on, but I just keep going. I just enjoy it, although I'm definitely not a graceful runner. Anyways, I was on a run and I was praying and thinking, and that's kind of like my quiet time, my space just to be by myself. And for whatever reason, that passage from 2 Corinthians chapter 5 came to mind, where Paul is talking about the role of the church and our role as followers of Jesus are to be ambassadors of what God is doing, to be agents of reconciliation, inviting people back to Jesus, calling people back to Jesus. And I was thinking about that idea as I was running, and I thought, you know what? A family reunion is like, that's kind of what's going on. People from all over the place who've gone in different directions are invited to come back together in one place at one time to share this idea. And I thought, man, in a spiritual way, isn't that what God is doing? He has set the table for us. Jesus has prepared the feast. He's done all the work, and he's inviting us to take a seat back at the table. For those who have nothing to do with Jesus, have nothing to do with the church, the name reunion, even for them, means something because it probably conjures up this idea of a family reunion. And I thought, that's a great name for a church because it has so many different layers of what it can mean. And it can mean something for those who have nothing to do with faith or Jesus, and those of us who have a desire and have said we're followers of Jesus, it also has rich layers of depth. And so we named our church Reunion. Now, that got going. At the same time, I was having conversations with other people who were interested in planting churches. And as we kind of got into that, they said, hey, why don't we like experiment with working more intentionally together? Wouldn't that be good? And so we began to kind of kick that around. Instead of just doing these independent church plants, what if we say, hey, what if we started working together? And as we started doing that, we started to pay attention to the things we were discovering with our group in Oakville. And instead of writing a document that says, you know, in an aspirational way, here's who we want to be, we said, what are we noticing about the way God is working in us here and now? So let's try to capture what's happening. So it's summing up what we're experiencing, but it's also in some ways aspirational as well. It's who we are right now, but also who we want to be. And so we began to write these things down, and we call them our culture statements. And so we have six culture statements that now are owned by any church that joins the Reunion Network. They're local churches with their own decision-making, their own leadership teams, their own budgets, but there's an intentional connection, choosing to work together and rallying around these six culture statements. And these are the culture statements. The first one is pupils, a culture of apprenticeship, talking about what it means to be a disciple and follower of Jesus. People, a culture of table, talking about the way in which we gather around the table, we share meals, and we sharpen and work together. Partygoers, a culture of celebration. That may be a strange one for you, but believing that it's important to celebrate and be in each other's lives in all kinds of ways together, to throw kingdom parties and invite people to the feast. Peacemakers, a culture of reconciliation, believing that we are to be agents of hope and reconciliation, working to bring and reestablish God's shalom, his peace, in all parts of our culture and our world. Pioneers, a culture of adventure and innovation, being willing to try new things, to adopt new things, to experiment, to just kind of go out in different ways in an adventurous kind of way. And then the last one is planters, a culture of multiplication, believing that the church should be a growing living organism that continues to plant and establish new communities. And so those are the six culture statements that now give shape and definition and a common language to what has become the Reunion Network. When we were praying in our living room, we never thought a network would come out of it. We simply were trying to do what we felt was about being faithful to what God is inviting us to do in that moment. But it's turned now into a network of churches across Canada, even now into the Middle East. We have a church in Kuwait, and now also a church in Colombia. So it's just a crazy thing. Nine churches all together, working together, and it's just been a wonderful experience. Anyways, I could talk about the network and what we're discovering all day long. So if you have any other questions or you want to talk about it, please reach out. I would love to have that conversation. But let me shift gears here now to some of the things we're learning across the network, and maybe something I hope will be an encouragement to you in your pursuit to connect with spiritual but not religious people. Let me just ask you this question. Let's transition with this question. If you could share a meal with anyone in the world, who would it be? Living or dead, but if you could share a meal with anyone, who would it be? So think about that for a second. Now, let me just say, there's probably this tension. We should probably say Jesus. So let's just say if we're followers of Jesus this morning, yes, we're all gonna say Jesus. That would be amazing. So let's just kind of say Jesus is a given. Who's your backup option? If Jesus is not available, his schedule is full, who would you pick? And why would you pick that person? So for me, here's who I'd pick. I'd pick Neil Young. Now, I think Neil Young is like a love him or hate him kind of person with his music. I love his music. I always have. I find him to be just intriguing. I love the way he writes. I love his voice. Now, my wife, on the other hand, would say like his voice sounds like a dying animal. So I know it's a love it or hate it kind of thing. But if I had to share a meal with someone, it would be Neil Young. I've read books about him. I've read articles. I've read interviews. I've watched documentaries. I listened to all his music. For whatever reason, he's just always kind of grabbed me, and I would love to spend time with him. I think it would just be amazing to sit and have a meal and get to learn from him and talk to him and ask him all kinds of questions. And I know in a day, like in this point in time, even the idea of sharing a meal and being in the same room with people feels a little bit like a dream, as we're in, what, month 14 or 15 of this pandemic, and lockdowns come and go, and rules change, and how we can be together and not be together keeps changing. So even the idea of sharing a meal maybe feels like a distant memory or a hope that you kind of have way down in the future that you hope to be able to reclaim. But I think there's something really, really special about being around a table and sharing a meal together that I think we're discovering has a more significant part to play and should have a more significant part to play in the life of the church than perhaps it has right now. That maybe the table is our way forward. Sharing meals together is our way forward as followers of Jesus to connect with people in a much deeper and more intentional way. So let me just quickly, let's jump to a passage of scripture. One of my favorite stories Traditionally, it's jump only kind of really talked about during the Easter season or just after Easter. So if you have your Bible or flip open your app to Luke chapter 24, I'm going to roll through this pretty quickly for the sake of time, but it might be a familiar story to some of you. So hopefully this isn't brand new, but if it is, feel free to go back, read it again, think about it again, but let's just read here. This is Luke chapter 24, beginning at verse 13. This is traditionally known as the road to Emmaus story, the walk to Emmaus story. So let me just read this. That same day, two of Jesus's followers were walking to the village of Emmaus, 7 miles from Jerusalem. So when it says that same day, this is the same day that after Jesus has been crucified and been buried, this is the same day that the women then have gone to the tomb and discovered that the tomb is empty. That's the same day. And now they're walking, they're leaving Jerusalem for this village of Emmaus. It's about a 3-hour walk. So they're out walking, heading that way. It says this in verse 14, as they walked along, they were talking about everything that had happened. As they talked and discussed these things, Jesus himself suddenly came and began walking with them, but God kept them from recognizing him. So in our culture, it's really weird to be in step with someone you don't know as you're walking, right? Think about it this way. If you're in a busy city, there can be people all over and you don't really think about it. But when you're in a quiet, isolated space and you stop, say, at a crosswalk, and someone comes up beside you and then the walking sign appears, the light goes green, it's always a little bit of this dance, isn't it? About like, how long do you walk close together? So usually one person or the other, picks up the pace to try to create some separation and distance, because it's strange to just be walking along with someone you don't know. But here we find these two people leaving Jerusalem on this walk for a few hours, and all of a sudden this person they don't know falls into step with them and begins walking with them. I'm not sure if that felt weird to them, but they didn't know it was Jesus. They were kept from recognizing it to be Jesus. This is what he says to them. Verse 17, what are you discussing so intently as you walk along? They stopped short, sadness written across their faces. Then one of them, Cleopas, replied, you must be the only person in Jerusalem who hasn't heard about all the things that have happened there the last few days. What things? Jesus asked. The things that happened to Jesus, the man from Nazareth, they said. He was a prophet who did powerful miracles, and he was a mighty teacher in the eyes of God and all the people. This is like one of those moments that he's asking, like, what are you talking about so intently? And it kind of shocks them. They're like, how can you not know? He says, what things are you talking about? What things are you referring to? And then they kind of tell a little bit about Jesus, this great teacher who performed miracles. He has been handed over and crucified. Like, how can you not know this? The whole city of Jerusalem was abuzz about this for so long. Like, how can you possibly not know this? Kind of relate that to my experience sometimes with my teenagers when they'll mention some kind of pop culture reference and I have no idea who they're talking about. And they give me the look like, Dad, how can you not know? Like recently, we were watching the Grammy Awards, the Music Awards, if you follow along with that ever. We're a music family, we love music, and so we always watch the Grammy Awards together, or as often as we can. And some of the acts that came on to perform, I had never heard of them. Like there was a point in time where I knew everything about music and pop music, and if you're on the Grammys, I for sure knew about you. But this year I found myself on a number of occasions being like, who on earth is that person, or who's that? And often my kids would look at me like, who are you? How do you not know? And that's kind of what comes to mind when Jesus says, like, what things? What are you talking about? That the disciples would have been like, who are you? How do you not know? Everybody knows what's going on with you. What's wrong? And then they continue in verse 20. Our leading priests, other religious leaders, handed him over to be condemned to death, and they crucified him. We had hoped he was the Messiah who would come to rescue Israel. All this happened 3 days ago. See, they're talking about who Jesus was, the things he had done, and they're also like kind of showing their cards. They're saying, we had hoped he was something more. We had hoped he was going to be the Messiah, the one to come and rescue us, to reestablish the prominence of the nation of Israel, to throw off the oppression of the Roman Empire. We had hoped he was the Messiah, but I guess not, because he's been handed over. Continues, then some women from our group of his followers were at his tomb earlier this morning, and they came back with an amazing report. They said his body was missing, and they had seen angels who told them Jesus was alive. Some of our man ran out to sea, and sure enough, his body was gone, just as the women had said. So clearly there's this deep sense of sadness and regret and loss, not only at losing a friend who had been killed, but also the loss of a dream that maybe he was the one they were waiting for, this Messiah figure. Jesus then says to them in verse 25, "You foolish people, you find it so hard to believe that all that the prophets wrote in scriptures, wasn't it clearly predicted that the Messiah would have to suffer all these things before entering his glory?" Then Jesus took them through the writings of Moses and all the prophets and explained from the scriptures all the things concerning himself. So he's like, "How do you miss this? What's wrong with you guys?" And then he begins working through the teachings of scripture and begins to point to, like, all these things that you didn't fully understand, let me now explain them to you. He spends the rest of the walk in a teaching kind of posture and moment. Verse 28, "By this time they were nearing Emmaus. At the end of their journey, Jesus acted as if he was going on. But they begged him, 'Stay the night with us since it's getting late.' So he went home with them. As they sat down to eat, he took bread and blessed it, and he broke it and gave it to them. Suddenly," verse 31, "suddenly their eyes were open and they recognized him. And at that moment, he disappeared." So they invite Jesus to spend the night. They have spent now time walking in this really deep conversation together, this learning together, this sharing kind of time together and ideas and thoughts together, and they invite him to stay. They still don't know who he is. It's not until they sit down and Jesus takes the bread and blesses it, breaks and blesses it, that their eyes are opened and now they recognize who has been with them this whole time. And then he disappears. In a flash, he's just kind of gone. And this is what they say to each other: "Didn't our hearts burn within us as he talked with us on the road and explained the scriptures to us?" Wasn't there something going on as he was explaining this stuff to us? Like, did you notice that too? There was something profound and deep and beautiful that was happening. And so within the hour, they are on their way back to Jerusalem. So they go back and they say, "Hey, we've actually encountered the risen Jesus." When I was in grade 11, my family moved from Toronto, where we had been living, up to a town called Meaford up in Georgian Bay. And so that summer we moved. So I finished grade 10 in Toronto and I started grade 11 in this new high school in Meaford. And one of the most difficult things about changing schools was the first couple weeks of lunch time, that lunch hour where you walk into the cafeteria and you have no idea where to sit. Because you don't know anyone. You're not sure where you belong. You're not sure how you fit in. And it's really strange. You know, sharing a meal, yes, it feeds and nourishes our body, but there's something about how you sit and who you sit with that helps you identify your place, your sense of belonging, your sense of purpose. And when you don't know where to sit and who to share a meal with, you're left feeling like, I don't know how I fit in and where I belong. And I think there's something spiritually profound about what's happening when Jesus sits at the table with his disciples. If you read through the Gospel of Luke, you find story after story where Jesus is either at a dinner party or a banquet, or he's on his way to one, or he's just leaving one. This idea of shared meals is woven all throughout Luke's gospel. And I think it's more than just a coincidence. I think he's pointing to something. There's something deeply profound about what happens when we share a meal and sit together. In her book, Making Room, Recovering Hospitality as a Christian Tradition, Christine Poole writes this: "A shared meal is the activity most closely tied to the reality of God's kingdom, just as it is the most basic expression of hospitality." It's the activity most closely tied to the reality of God's kingdom. When we are sharing a meal, when we're at the table together, there's something that points to the kingdom of God that takes place there. There's something profound and sacred that happens. So here's one of the things that we're learning across the network. Specifically, I want to key in on this idea of the shared meal. I think we're discovering that being at the table is more than just a nice idea. It's actually needs to be a part of our intentional strategy as a church. Sometimes churches will say, "I don't know what it looks like to have a discipleship program at our church. We're not really sure what it means to have like an evangelism strategy. And also, what does it mean for us to reach out in a compassionate way in our neighborhood?" I just want to suggest that perhaps the table is a place where all three of those ideas come together. Hey, you're hungry? You need something to eat? Come on over for dinner. Hey, you're curious about who Jesus is and what this way of Jesus is all about? Come on over and have dinner with me. hey, you're interested in growing as a disciple and follower, as an apprentice of Jesus? Come on over and have dinner with me. It's the place where all these things come together. I think there's something fascinating. The table is a place where we discover that it allows there to be this sense of welcome. You know, when you set the table and you invite people, you know that you're anticipating and planning for them to be there. And so everyone has a seat and everyone is able to look at each other and recognize it's almost like a level playing field. We all belong here. We all have a place here. It's a place of welcome. You can bring strangers together, introduce them, and there's this sense of belonging that then comes together. And then as you have intentional time over the days, over the weeks, over the months, it also becomes a place of mission and purpose, that the values with which you kind of, that hold you together around the table, they start to take root, and that becomes your sense of not only welcome, belonging, but also a sense of purpose and mission. This is who we are, and this is what we're supposed to do. And so that's what we're discovering, that the table needs to have a more central place in who we are as followers of Jesus. Sometimes when we think about a small group ministry, you can picture this idea if you've ever been to a small group Bible study before. You arrive and you have a few snacks so that you can then get to the important part of the night, the Bible study. May I suggest that we flip that on our heads, that instead of having a few snacks in order to get to the most important things, what about instead if the meal was the important thing? That you're having people to your house for a meal. And that while you have that meal, you talk about life. You talk about ups and downs and struggles and victories. You talk about what it means to follow Jesus. You read scripture, you even pray together. But it's around the table where everyone finds their place of belonging and welcome and purpose that all these things happen. Because there's something about the table that unites us, that brings us together, that helps us see each other as sister and brother, as equal. That it's maybe more than just, hey, it's good to enjoy a meal together. There's something that God does when we're in those places together, those physical spaces, that awakens us spiritually. Daryl Bach in his commentary says this. He says, it is no accident that Jesus is revealed as he sits having table fellowship with the two disciples. It's no accident. The table was the place for fellowship in the ancient world. Here, family and friends gathered to share time with each other. Luke has underscored the importance of meal scenes throughout the gospel, his gospel. The table was a place where Jesus was heard and where his presence came across most intimately. This fact suggests that Jesus reveals himself in the midst of the basic moments of life. He is at home in the midst of our everyday activity. If you've read anything about the history of the early church and the rise of the early church, I don't think it's any coincidence, and it's no accident that the way the church was established and the way the church grew was in homes and around the table. How did this obscure group of people who followed this teacher from Nazareth, how did they grow from hundreds of followers to thousands, to tens of thousands, to hundreds of thousands, to millions of people? How did that even happen? How did this growth happen? Well, it happened in people's houses, and it happened around the table as they were sharing meals. They were breaking bread. Whenever you are together, do this in remembrance of me. Whenever you're eating bread and drinking wine, do this in remembrance of me. Remember the one who gives you purpose, who has welcomed you to the table, who gives you meaning, identity, and belonging. Whenever you eat and drink, do this in remembrance of me. The table is something special. It's more than just a piece of furniture in our house where we just nourish our physical bodies. I'd like to suggest that we need to think about it in a new way. Could it be the place where mission happens? The place where we find our own purpose as followers of Jesus? Now again, in this COVID era, the idea of having people over for dinner just feels like this dream. Wouldn't it be great if we could open up our homes and have people over? It just doesn't seem possible right now. But we believe that one day we will be back there. One day we'll be able to extend hospitality and open up our homes. So across the network, we're experimenting with what it means to have our homes be a central place and meals be the central mechanism by which we disciple, by which we welcome, by which we feed people and care for them, demonstrate our love for them. We allow people who are spiritual but not religious to find a place, and that their voice matters, that they're seen, and they have an equal seat at the table. We gather around the table together. We admit that we are starting with our bias of like we are followers of Jesus, but everyone has a seat and a place and belongs. And we demonstrate our love for Jesus by the way we love and care for them. It forces us to slow down, to look each other in the eye, to extend ourselves for them. And I think there's something beautiful for us to discover in that. I read this quote a number of years ago. I don't even know where I found it, but I wrote it down. It said, "Perhaps before we invite people to Jesus or invite them to church, we should invite them to dinner." Perhaps before we invite people to Jesus or invite them to church, we should invite them to dinner. So we're still early in this whole thing. We don't claim by any means to have the answers, and I'm not suggesting you stop doing what you're doing. In fact, what I'm saying is perhaps when you're thinking about what does it mean to continue on and to move into new ways as a church, maybe it's not stopping things, maybe it's adding this into your rhythm. What does it mean for you to set the table and invite people to the table? 2 Corinthians 5, you've been given this mission, this purpose, this task as ambassadors of reconciliation, inviting people back to the table, inviting them to the table that Jesus has set. And maybe that really means invite them to your tables. Model for them what a follower of Jesus looks like. Invite them into your personal spaces. Welcome them and introduce them to Jesus. I love that scene that they don't know Jesus is with them at all, and it's not until they're at the table and they're having a meal that their eyes are opened and they recognize who Jesus is. And I believe that we're learning together that when we're around the table and we're pointing people to Jesus and we're sharing scripture and sharing life with people, I believe and I've seen it that people's eyes are opened and they begin to understand who Jesus is in completely brand new ways. And people are finding Jesus for the first time. So let me just encourage you, friends, again, if you want to talk any more about this, I know time goes really quickly, but if you want to talk any more about this, please reach out. Josh has all my info. You can get me anytime. I'd love to have a conversation with you. We're just learning and trying new things, believing that we want to introduce more and more people to Jesus. And as followers of Jesus now, we want to become activated and passionate about what it means to introduce people and welcome them to the table of Jesus. So let me just pray for you, and hopefully we can catch each other at some point down the line. Jesus, thank you that you are the one who has prepared and set the table, the feast, the banquet for us, and you are welcoming us back to the table. You provide the mechanism for us to have restored relationship with you and with each other. You've given us this task, this ministry of reconciliation, announcing the good news of Jesus and welcoming people back. And so perhaps you're helping us imagine again what our homes and our dining room tables and a simple act of sharing a meal, believing that maybe there's something more in that for us as the church today. Following the patterns of the early church, the growth, the discipleship, the explosion of the early church, that perhaps what we need to do before we introduce them to our broader church and invite them to a church service is invite people over for dinner and get to know them for who they are, to look them in the eye, to encourage them to get to know their stories. And that in some way that we don't understand, your spirit is at work in all of that, drawing people to yourself. So Jesus, we just say we want to be faithful and willing to take new risks for you, to try new things, and so continue to lead us. Jesus, we love you. It's a privilege to serve and to be connected in a denominational way with this, with these friends at Westheights. And God, thank you for your broader church, all the good things you're doing, and the ways you invite us into partnership and participation in you. Jesus, we do this all for your glory, for your honor. We pray this in your name. Amen. All right, take care, everyone. Peace.
Matt, thank you so much for being a part of our service this morning. Thank you for sharing what the Reunion at Work is doing and the heart behind it. And thank you for giving us a challenge from Scripture and something to think about as we think about how are we going to engage our friends, our family, our neighbors, our city for Jesus. And so there's some good stuff there for us. Thank you very much for being a part of our service this morning. Now, as we wrap up our service this morning, I do want to remind everybody watching that we have two things that you can do if you're watching this at Sunday at 10:30 or whatever time the service is ending. Matt, thank you so much for speaking to us. I just want to say thank you to Matt for being a part of our service this morning. Thank you for talking to us about the Reunion Network. That is it's so cool to hear the things that are going on in that part of our denominational church family. Thank you for sharing that. And thank you for giving us some things to think about as we think about how do we engage our friends, our family, our coworkers, our neighbors, our city for Jesus. So thank you for speaking to us this morning. As we transition to the end of our service time, I just want to say something to those of you who are watching this service Sunday morning. We have two things that we're hoping that you might consider participating in right about now. The first is our virtual foyer that happens every week. And so that's just an informal time to connect. And so if you want to do that, the link is in the description of this video below. The something new that we're trying this week is we're having an after service prayer time. And the link for that is also in the description below or beside me or wherever the video description is that you are watching. We really are excited about being able to spend about half an hour praying for one another, praying for some of the things going on in our world. And so hoping to see some of you at our prayer time. So two things, prayer time, and or if that doesn't, you know, work for you, you'd rather just have some casual conversation, then we have the virtual foyer, and hope that we see you at one of those things. Anyways, Westheights, have a great week. We'll talk to you soon. Bye.